Hey, WayFam, thanks for tuning in. We pray that today's message impacts your life. Let's get ready for this service.
We're going to get really get into an amazing word on healing. Jesus, our healer. And I really believe that we can make an impact in this world greater than ever before,
right,
with our faith, our message, and also the good works that we can do through bringing a message of healing as well.
Man, that's powerful. I looked at the teaching a little bit earlier, and I made this statement that it's probably the best teaching, clearest teaching on healing I've ever seen. Before we jump into the teaching really quick, next Wednesday, we got healing evangelist Nassar Iqbal is going to be with us. He actually was in a coma. God visited him, and he got healed. Take a look at this quick promo video. Next Wednesday, live, Nassar Iqbal. It's going to be a great service. Take a look at this promo video.
This Wednesday, April 29th at 7 o'clock, our healing services will continue with a live interview of Nassar Iqbal, a man who was literally brought back from the brink of death by a powerful encounter with Jesus Christ himself. And witness the gift of healing this man now walks in. Tune in next Wednesday, 7 o'clock, for a live service with Nassar Iqbal.
It's going to be awesome. Next week, don't miss it. Nassar Iqbal is going to be live here at the church, and we're going to have a dynamic service. Pastor Marco, we started a new series entitled Jesus is Our Healer. Mm-hmm. Part one was last week. This week is part two. I'm so excited about this topic. There's no greater time right now, because right now the coronavirus is going. People are panicking, but people are dealing with sickness, and not only physical sickness, people are dealing with emotional sickness as well.
Right. You know, right now, this is the most relevant subject that we could talk about, especially when sickness literally has shut down the world. And there are no solutions. And I heard the other day, actually, it was yesterday, that they were saying when the second wave of coronavirus comes in, they're predicting it's going to be worse.
I know. That's what they said.
And they don't have a vaccine. And they're saying if they got a vaccine within a year period of time, it would be a miracle. Wow. But they're saying maybe 2 years, they'll have a vaccine for it. So you know what's going to happen? It's going to create a window for everyone to have to turn to one name above every name. And it's the name of Jesus. When you think about all the options for healing, there are no answers. Even if you talk about Muhammad, he's not a healer.
That's right.
You know, Confucius is not a healer. No. Buddha is not a healer. Jesus was the only one that came and actually did miracles of healing, which was proof that he was the Messiah or the Savior.
I was talking to Nassar Iqbal, the healing evangelist coming next week, and he was saying that even the Muslims, they believe that Jesus heals.
Right.
Because Muhammad doesn't heal.
Right.
So right now, even Nassar, he has a station on a fire stick. It's actually the Muslim fire stick. And thousands are getting saved through the healing power of Jesus Christ.
Right.
And tonight, you're going to be talking about the four keys to being healed.
Right.
What is key number one? Receiving a healing. What is
now, when we're talking about keys, this is what we're talking about. Something that unlocks something. You know, so if I have a key, I can unlock it and have access to it.
Wow.
So when we're talking about keys today, we're going to have keys to get an access to Jesus' healing power in our lives. And not only in our lives, through our lives.
Right, that's good. So what is key number one?
Key number one is you got to believe that healing is God's will for you. You'll never receive any miracle from God, including healing, salvation, freedom, restoration, without believing that it's for you. What I mean by that is you could believe that healing is real. You could believe that God heals. But the question is, do you believe that God wants to heal you? God, this is what we need to discuss. Does God? Do you really believe that God wants to heal you?
Yeah, because so many people, you know, they deal with sickness, and maybe right now you're sick, and you're kind of wondering, is it God's will? Is it just something I just live with? How do I fight against it? Man, this is good stuff.
Yeah.
So the first key, believe that healing is God's will for you. I love the scripture that you have on that point as well.
Well, the big question we ask ourselves, how do I know that healing is God's will for me? How do I know that? Where do I find out?
Right.
Where do I find God's will?
Yeah.
Do I ask my friends? Do I ask my pastor?
Right.
Where do I find God's will? So God has made it very simple. You find God's will in his word.
Man,
it's simple.
Good.
In Psalms 107:20, it says this. He sent, look at this. He sent his word and healed them and rescued them from their destruction. So when God sends his word, it saves, it delivers. But in this scripture, it says his word also heals. And in scripture, man, you'll see a pattern. Jesus would be teaching. Yeah. And after the word was sent, man, people by the masses would be healed.
Gosh.
So God sends his word. Now we're asking about, is it God's will to heal? Well, God is saying here, when I send my word, the result after the word is spoken is this. People get saved, set free, and healed.
Man, that's powerful. Even like we learned last week, it's a dual package. Jesus came and died on the cross, not only for our sins, that's number one, so we could have forgiveness and have eternal life, but also healing. And people are, they're asking. I've asked myself, when I was sick a long time ago, I had it for a while. I couldn't even drink water. I was at the point, and I began to have those thoughts, is it God's will for me? And as a scripture you have here, God really explained this in his word. There was a guy, even over 2,000 years ago, this question was asked.
Right.
Can you explain that?
So 2,000 years ago, the question was asked, is it God's will to be healed?
Yeah.
Is it his will that we be healed? Well, there was a man that was a leper, and he asked this question over 2,000 years ago. In Matthew 8:2, it says this, right away, a man with leprosy came up and knelt before him, before Jesus. And he said, Lord, if you are willing, you can make me clean. So he knew this, that Jesus could heal him. But the question he had, though, are you willing? Because that's the struggle I'm struggling with.
Right.
And then Jesus answered the question. And he said, reaching out his hand, Jesus reached out his hand. Jesus touched him, saying, while he's touching him, he's saying, I am willing. Be made clean immediately. Immediately, his leprosy was cleansed. That means he was immediately healed. But the question was asked over 2,000 years ago, do you want me to be healed? Is it your will that I be healed? And Jesus answered, I am willing. So let's get that question out of our minds, and because it causes doubt and unbelief. And we'll never receive anything from God when we're not sure that God wants it for us.
That's right. The Bible says that when you're double-minded, you're wavering, or you're wavering your faith, you can't receive from God.
Right.
And all the enemy wants to do is plant a doubt. And I think even me, when I dealt with the sickness, it was a period of time where it looks like it was getting worse.
Right.
Maybe somebody's watching now, and can you maybe encourage someone? Maybe it looks like it's getting worse. What is God doing behind the scenes?
And that's why we need to have teachings like this to build our faith. What's going to get us through the difficult times or the symptoms of a sickness is our faith. Because the symptoms speak, but also God speaks. And if we're not actually hearing what God is saying about this subject, the sickness or the pain or the suffering can be so loud, it'll be deafening, and it convinces us that it's so strong, it's not going anywhere.
And that's where the enemy brings that doubt during those times where it's lasting for so long, but God is moving. And maybe even watching right now, God is going to continue. Even right now, God's healing you right now. Even at the end of our service, we're going to have a time of prayer. You could type in your prayers and forward them to us. We're going to be praying for you guys. Expect the healing. This is a day of miracles. I love this next statement that you put on here. Jesus restated his will to heal by giving his disciples the authority to heal. Can you explain that?
Now, Jesus, you're wondering, does Jesus heal? Well, we know Jesus heals. Yeah. But then he goes on to say, it's not just that I'm a healer.
Right.
I'm training you to be a healer.
Yes.
So by him giving authority to his disciples to heal, he was restating his will in them. And look at Matthew 10:1. It says this. And he called to him his 12 disciples. And look at this. And gave them authority over unclean spirits to cast them out and power over the devil, yes, and to heal every disease and every affliction. So Jesus gave them power to cast out demons and heal the sick. Now, when you see these two together, demons and sickness, it's putting them in the same bag. And it's saying both of them are enemies that I've defeated, and I'm giving you authority to come against both of them.
Ooh, that's powerful. So God's giving us authority, and I think there's a misconception or maybe a misunderstanding that maybe only a healing evangelist could heal, or it was just for Jesus' disciples, but God is showing us he's given us the authority to heal.
Well, look, he goes on to say, Jesus heals. Let's follow it. His disciples, he gives them authority to heal every disease and every affliction. So it doesn't matter what it is, I'm giving you authority. Now, it's easy to say, well, then, yeah, because there were Jesus' disciples and of course, Jesus. But what about me?
Right.
What about here? While we're going through the coronavirus in 2020, does Jesus still heal? Now, this is really good.
Man.
So Jesus told us this, gave the disciples authority to heal. Right. But then he goes on to emphasize his will to heal, and he gives every single believer an authority and a command to lay hands on the sick to recover.
Man.
So Jesus, look at it. Jesus showed that it was his will to heal the sick by commanding believers to heal the sick by laying on of hands.
Man.
In Mark 16, 17, he says, these special powerful works will be done by who? By those who have put their trust in me. Look at this.
Wow.
He's saying those that have put their trust in God will be able to do special powerful works or signs and wonders. I want you to think about
it. Powerful.
If Jesus is in you and he's giving you authority, this is what he's saying. I'm the same yesterday, today, and forever. And what I did then, I will now do through you.
Man.
So it goes on to say, give them special power to who? For those who put their trust in me. In my name, they will put out demons or cast them out. Mm. They will speak with languages they've never learned. They will pick up snakes. If they drink anything poison, any poison, it will not hurt them. But look at the key. They will put their hands on the sick and they will be healed.
Man, that's powerful.
This is a promise to every single believer.
Yes.
So if we're wondering, is it God's will that I be healed? It's even greater than that. It's not only God's will that you be healed, it's God's will that you and I become supernatural healers.
Yes.
That's powerful.
Can I ask a question just really quick before even try to tackle number two? Why do you think most Christians, we're not operating in this power or we're not doing this? We don't see it more. How come most Christians not using this authority?
Well, I think, first of all, we're not hearing about it.
Hmm.
We're not, faith comes by hearing this, that these scriptures, realistically, and if you look at videos of the modern day church, they're more motivational videos, not necessarily equipping videos.
Right. Wow.
So what Jesus did was equip his disciples. He showed them, trained them, and equipped them to go out there and do what he did. So we need to get faith again, but also there's counter teaching.
Yeah, yeah.
That causes doubt.
Oh, yeah.
That makes you start thinking, well, I don't know if healing's for today.
Right, yeah, I've heard that.
Or maybe when I'm sick, I'm really giving glory to God.
Right.
And you start thinking, well, I'm kind of confused. Am I supposed to be healed? Or am I supposed to just, faith it out while I'm sick and just accept the sickness? So until we get some clarity that God wants to heal you and it's God's will to heal you, we won't be able to receive anything.
Man, and we tapped on it last weekend. Maybe you missed it. I want to ask this again. Does everyone get healed?
Now, not everybody gets healed, but every believer gets healed.
Every believer.
Every believer gets healed here or in heaven, but every believer gets healed. Because Jesus came to establish the kingdom of heaven on earth.
Right.
In heaven, there's no one sick. In heaven, there's no one that has cancer.
That's exactly
but we could experience, Jesus said this, pray like this, thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth the way it is in heaven. So what that means is we can access heaven and his kingdom and his power and authority right here on earth, and we can be healed here.
I love it. So key number one, Believe that healing is God's will for you. Is it God's will? Yes, believe. What is key number two, receiving a healing?
Key number two is this. Resist sickness and receive healing. Resist sickness and receive healing. Now, the reason I say resist, because it's so easy to receive sickness and resist healing.
Yeah.
That means we get a little sniffles and I think, oh man, I think I got the coronavirus. Right? You get a little fever. It's so easy to receive because the symptoms.
Yeah, we say I'm coming down with the flu. It feels like I'm catching a cold right now. Or I've said that before.
Right. I'm catching a cold. Where'd you get that from, catching? Like, how do you catch this stuff?
I know.
Right. Or I'm under the weather right now. Yeah. And we have all these sayings that actually cause us to welcome the sickness instead of resisting the sickness. I want you to get this.
Powerful.
We should never be in a place that we ever receive sickness. It's not for us. Jesus died so we could be healed. Jesus resurrected so we could have a new life. Jesus was wounded so we could be healed and restored. Yeah. By his stripes we're healed. That's our inheritance.
Man, that's powerful. You're saying resist sickness. How would you explain, how do you resist something? How do you explain that? Resist it.
Well, we resist it by, first of all, not accepting it. So I resist it by doing this, by praying to receive healing. Mm. I resist it. I resist it through my words. That means I'm careful what I'm saying.
Right, okay.
And I'm careful what I'm saying over myself.
Right.
I'm not even allowing myself to say things that are in agreement with sickness over my life.
Got it. That's
so
good.
I resist it by also rebuking it. So I don't receive sickness. I rebuke this sickness in the name of Jesus.
Yes.
And you start pushing it away instead of accepting it.
Man.
Now, Jesus resisted sickness for you. Resisted sickness for you so you could receive healing. And in Isaiah 53:5, it says this: he was wounded for our rebellious acts. He was crushed for our sins. I would get this.
Wow.
So he was wounded for us being rebellious. So I received that.
Yes.
I'm sure most people are saying, I received that. Yes. I've been rebellious. Number two.
That's right.
He was crushed for our sins. Why? I understand that.
Yeah.
How Jesus was crushed for my sins. That means he went through all this pain and suffering, not because he did anything wrong. He took on my sin.
Man.
And most people say, I received that.
Yeah.
And he was punished so that we could have peace. That means he took on all the judgment so we can have a relationship with God. There's no judgment. There's no condemnation for believers. They are forgiven.
Love it.
Because Jesus paid the price.
Right.
So we could have a peaceful relationship. We're not at war with God. We're in fellowship and relationship with God because Jesus paid the price.
That's
no
powerful.
Judgment for Christians.
Man,
but this
good.
Is what it says. And I love this.
And
listen, we receive healing from his wounds. So in the whole package, healing is part of the package. We receive healing. That means we don't receive sickness, we receive healing. We resist sickness and we receive healing.
Man.
We must learn how to resist it and not accept it.
Man, I love what you put on your notes. Warfare principle. Here's a warfare principle. Resist everything that doesn't come from God.
Right.
Can you expound on that? Man, I love that.
Don't we do this anyways? If the devil came to you, you say, I resist you.
Right.
I rebuke you, right? Sin. We all know this. Sin is so destructive. That means doing things our way.
Right.
We need to stop doing it our way and accepting the devil's temptations and going with him. No, I resist that temptation. No, I don't want that. So we know how to, we know it's right to resist the devil's ideas.
Yeah.
But have you ever thought that it's also right for us to resist resist sickness? And I want you why? Because it doesn't come from God. Why would I receive anything that doesn't come from God? Jesus said, the Word of God says this. It says, I've not given you a spirit of fear, but power, love, and a sound mind. So why receive fear? It doesn't come from God. You know what does come from God? Faith.
Yeah.
You know what does come from God? Healing. So where Jesus went, there was healing.
That's right.
Nowhere Jesus went did he ever cause sickness.
No.
Jesus never caused sickness. He always caused healing. Man. The one that causes sickness, I would say, where does sickness come from? The fall of man.
Yeah, can you explain that?
The fall of man. So when Adam sinned, sickness now was part, it entered our bloodstream.
Right.
Our bloodstream became contaminated.
Wow.
That's what happened when Adam and Eve sinned. There was no sickness in the Garden of Eden.
That's why everyone has to receive Jesus Christ, the Lord and Savior, because of what Adam did.
Of course. And so, so Jesus needed to redeem us. From the fall. But he redeemed us from the complete fall.
Man.
That means sickness was part of the fall. So that's why we receive, by his wounds, we receive healing. So this is important to get.
It's powerful.
Now, resist everything that doesn't come from God. Now, I'm going to say a big statement. I want you to get this. Healing comes from Jesus. And sickness comes from sin and the devil. You got to get this. Now, there's a portion of scripture here. So the Spirit of God brings healing, and the spirit of the devil brings sickness.
Right,
that's why we always resist it.
Right.
Let's look at the scripture in Luke 13, 11. It says, and there was a woman, look at this, for 18 years that had an illness.
There it goes.
So there's a lady that had, for 14 years, she had an illness. But look at this.
18 years.
Caused by a spirit or demon.
Hold on, can you say that again? Hold on.
So, okay, so now
look at the word of God. This is Luke chapter 13, verse 11. She's struggling for 18 years.
With a sickness.
By a sickness, and it's caused by who?
In this? So the illness was caused by a spirit or demon. She was bent over and could not straighten up at all. All we're saying is she was sick, and this did not come from God. It actually came from the realm of darkness.
Wow.
And the scripture says, when Jesus saw her, he called her over and said to her, woman, you are released from your illness.
Man.
So what he did was he healed her and set her free from the demon that was causing the sickness. And I'm not saying, oh my gosh, you're sick and you have a demon.
That's not
what we're talking about here. All we're saying is it doesn't come from God.
It doesn't come from God.
However we get it, it doesn't come from God. Coronavirus does not come from God.
That's right.
So all we're saying, if it doesn't come from God, why
receive it?
Nope. Why not resist it?
I love that.
And command it to go.
I love that. Warfare principle. Resist everything that doesn't come from God.
Right.
I love this statement you put here. What you resist goes. What you receive stays.
Wow.
What a powerful statement.
So what we resist goes. And that could be in a relationship. You're pushing someone away, eventually they're going to go away.
That's right.
It's just the way it is.
Yeah.
And what we receive and we celebrate and we accept stays. Yeah. So if we don't ever get to a point that we're actually resisting, looking at sickness as an enemy and start resisting it, it's going to stay.
Yes.
That's what the hospitals are all about.
Oh, yeah.
They are fighting for our health.
That's right.
And when we get sick, most of us go straight to the hospital to get some healing. Yeah. You know what we're doing? We're doing the best we can to resist sickness. Why not include Jesus in this?
Love
and
it.
Why not get involved in the process and say this? Okay, whatever I resist goes, and whatever I receive stays.
Man,
in James 4:7, it says, so place yourselves under God's authority. So he's saying, don't place yourself under Satan's authority. Don't place yourself under the authority of sickness, but place yourself under God's authority. Resist the devil and he will run away from you.
Man.
Now, this scripture has three parts. One is we submit to God. How do we submit to God? We submit to God's truth. We hear God's word and we accept it. That's why in churches that are alive, when there's a word that's said that we're in agreement with, this is what usually people will say. Amen. And what we're saying is, I'm in agreement with that.
I agree.
Or I receive that.
Right.
We don't amen or agree with the enemy.
No.
Or amen is, you know what amen means? Let it be done in my life. So we never amen a sickness.
No.
We never amen anything the enemy's doing. You know what we do? We submit to God. What do we submit to? God's word.
Authority.
So what God's word says is the final authority in our lives. How do I submit to God? I submit to God's word. And then the next thing, what I do is I resist the enemy with the truth of God.
Yes.
The enemy comes with lies. I go, no, the truth of God is by Jesus' wounds, yeah. I receive healing. Yeah. By his stripes, I am healed.
Yes.
It is God's will for me to be healed. So I resist your idea that's causing me to give into a temptation to receive something from the enemy.
Man.
But if I resist the enemy
right.
with the truth of God, you know what happens?
He runs. He runs away.
He goes.
I love it.
And I wonder tonight how many people, as we realize, you know what? I'm feeling sick.
Yeah.
It's no doubt about it. I have major symptoms, no doubt about it. I got diagnosed with something. It's been around for a long period of time. I understand. But maybe tonight is the night you're realizing, wait a second, I've not been resisting it, and I've been confused of whether it's been God's will to heal me or not.
Yeah.
And tonight, the air is being cleared out, and the devil is mad. And you know what we're going to do? We're going to resist the sickness.
Yes.
We're going to resist the bondage. We're going to resist the depression.
Yes.
We're going to resist the anxiety. And we're saying, you have no place here in the name of Jesus.
Yes.
And as we resist,
Amen.
You know what happens? It goes.
It goes. The devil runs away.
Runs away when we resist. If you don't resist, he stays.
Man.
But what you don't resist stays.
Woo, that's powerful. We're receiving things in our lives, and God is saying you have to resist. Fight against it.
Right.
Man, what is key number three for our healing?
Seek healing. Hmm. See, God is not going to give you something, Robert, you don't desire.
Right.
And truly seeking after.
Hmm.
We seek healing through our prayers, through our words, and even through our diet.
Yeah.
You can't say, I want to be healed I got cirrhosis of the liver and I want to be healed and you want to continue drinking.
Yeah.
That's not really seeking healing. That's seeking more cirrhosis.
Yeah. I do with acid reflux sometimes. And acid reflux for me and most people is because we eat the wrong stuff.
Right.
So the other day I ate something spicy and I was up all night. And Veronica, my wife, she goes, do you like that acid? You got to change your diet.
Right.
There's some things that we're doing and we're kind of bringing it on ourselves. I'm guilty
of
that.
Well, you know, that proves the point. You're not really seeking healing.
Yeah.
You were seeking a pizza.
I know.
And you got it. But that pizza came with your acid reflux.
I love it. Seek healing. I like this point that you made. Seeking healing and being healed come together. Can you explain that? I love that.
Because seeking and finding is a spiritual principle.
Hmm.
So if you seek something, you find it.
Right.
And it's a spiritual principle. I'm going to say, if you seek me, God says, if you seek me, you will find me.
Right.
So whatever, if you're looking for trouble, you're going to find it.
You will.
But whatever you're seeking is a spiritual principle.
Love that.
You will have contact with that. And that's why you could get someone and take them out of, let's say, San Bernardino.
Yeah.
You know, I want to get out of San Bernardino. There's so many drugs. And you could take them to Alaska.
Yeah.
If his heart has not changed, he will find the drugs. He will find the one Eskimo dealer out there. And because what you seek, you'll find.
You will find
it,
man.
It's a spiritual principle. So if we seek healing, we'll find it as well. Look at the scripture in Matthew 7:7. It says, ask and keep on asking.
Man.
And it will be given to you. Seek and keep on seeking.
Love it.
And you will find. Knock and keep on knocking, and the door will be open to you. For everyone, look at this.
Yes.
This is a spiritual principle. For everyone who keeps on
asking
receives, and everyone who keeps on seeking finds.
Man.
Who doesn't find? The one that's not seeking, or the one that stop seeking for it. Because you could get to a point that you just start accepting it because of so much pain and symptoms. You start thinking, well, I don't think it's just a waste of time.
Oh, yeah.
It's not going anywhere. But it seems like maybe it's meant to be.
Yeah, I've been
instead
there.
Of fighting it.
That's
it's
right.
easier not to fight.
Yeah, it is.
But there's
it
a problem.
Is.
When we don't fight, all we're allowing the enemy to do is fortify his position.
Gosh. I love the definition here on this word seek in the scripture.
Yeah.
It says to seek in order to find, aim at, strive after, to crave.
Right.
To crave and going after.
I desire.
Man, I love that. And you put something else on. Seek healing with perseverance.
Yeah.
You have a sickness. You're going through it. We got this portion of scripture. This lady saw healing for 12 years. But perseverance is a key.
Yeah. You said, when do we stop? We don't stop.
Yeah.
When do we stop resisting? We don't stop resisting sickness. Mm. When do we stop believing? We don't stop believing. When do we stop seeking? We never stop seeking until we have it.
Man,
I love that. So there was a man in the Bible that I want to just share with you. He was sick for 38 years. 38 years. So Jesus maybe is meeting him.
Yeah.
Well, Jesus is probably 33 years old, 32 years old. He's meeting this man, and this guy was sick like 5 years before Jesus was born.
Yeah, Jesus
he was already in this sickness for 38 years, but there's something special about him. Mm. For 38 years, he's not lost his desire to be healed.
Wow.
38 years later, he is still seeking a healing.
Yes, amen.
Still seeking a healing.
That's right.
And Matthew, look, wait a minute, I'm sorry. In John 5:5, it says this: one of the men lying there was sick for 38 years. When Jesus saw him and knew he had been ill for a long time, he asked him, "Would you like to get well?" So Jesus said, he's been sitting there, and Jesus knew he's been there for a long time. He was sick for 38 years. And Jesus asked him, "Would you like to get well?" Like, to me, I was like, what kind of question is that? Would you like to get well? I'm sick for 38 years.
Yes, I do.
But not everybody that's sick for 38 years wants to get well.
That's
so Jesus was saying, are you still, this is a question.
Are you still seeking?
He was digging. Are you still seeking for healing? Or have you let the sickness take over in your mind and you're just here hanging out and just watching other people get healed?
That's good.
And Jesus asked him the question.
Yeah.
And he goes, "I can't, sir," the sick man said, "for I have no one to put me into the pool when the water bubbles up. Someone always gets there ahead of me." Now, I want you to get this. Mm. He was sitting there, and this pool he's talking about would bubble up once a year. An angel would come and stir the water. Yeah. And this was the deal. The first person that would jump in would get healed.
Wow.
But he had a problem. He was in the right position, but he had no one to help him. So this is what happened. I don't know how many years he would come here. Maybe for 30 years, he would show up every single year for the water to turn. And he would be thinking, I don't know how I'm going to get in that water, but at least I'm going to put myself in a position. But I'm showing up because I still want to be healed. And Jesus, with his answer, realized, you sure do want to get healed.
Wow.
You're still seeking healing? Well, you know what? You're going to find it right now. And it's not going to be in that pool that bubbles up. I'm going to be your healer, and my healing has no limits to it. I'll heal you, and I'll heal everyone around here as well.
Powerful.
But the scripture says, Jesus told him, "Stand up, pick up your mat, and walk." Instantly, the man was what?
Healed.
He rolled up his sleeping mat and began walking for the first time in 38 years. But this miracle happened on the Sabbath. Isn't that amazing?
Powerful, man. That's great. Key number three, continue to seek healing. And Pastor Marco, number four, how to receive our healing.
Well, one of the things that we got to do is key number four is claim your healing, not your sickness. Mm. Claim your healing, not your sickness. You claim healing through proclaiming healing scriptures over yourself. And I want to ask you a question. What are you constantly saying over yourself?
Wow.
I'm not feeling good. I feel like a cold is coming on me. I'm getting worse. I'm afraid that the sickness my mom has, I think I got it now.
That's right.
But how about, there's a problem. As long as you're proclaiming, saying those things, you're a pro
for
claim.
Wow.
So I'm claiming, I'm for what I'm claiming. I want this in my life. It's crazy. So there's no way that we'll ever be healed proclaiming our sickness.
Wow, that's great.
We'll only be healed proclaiming our healing.
Man, that's good.
So there's a scripture in Psalms 41:3. It says, "The Lord will sustain him on his sickbed." So how do we proclaim our healing? What we do is proclaim healing scriptures and make them personal. Let's look at the scripture. "The Lord will sustain him on his sickbed. You will heal him on the bed where he lies."
Wow.
So personalize it. Claim it over yourself. This is what I would do. "The Lord will sustain me on my sickbed. He will heal me right here where I'm lying."
Man, you can put your name in there.
Yeah.
"The Lord will sustain Robert on my sickbed. He will heal Robert right here where I am laying."
Right.
Personalized scripture. I love that.
Now, personalize the scripture.
Wow.
"By his stripes, I am healed."
Man.
right? So you got to claim the healing scriptures over yourself. And now that's a conduit for God to have access to your life. Even salvation, you can't get saved without believing and confessing.
Believing and confessing, that's exactly
so why don't
right.
we confess our healing instead of, we're in the habit of confessing just our sickness.
Wow,
and the more
powerful.
We confess our sickness, all we're doing is developing a stronghold and we're saying, I'm for the sickness. I'm not resisting it. I'm readily accepting it. I'm not only accepting it, I'm proclaiming it.
Man, that's powerful. I love this topic tonight. And we even got some more notes.
Yeah.
But we want to start praying for some people here in a little bit as well. You know, the notes, we can't go over all of it again. On the app, there's a banner there that says message notes. You could go in more detail with this topic. But Pastor Mark, if you could close us out with this topic and even pray for salvation for someone. And even after party, we're going to be praying for the sick, and people are going to get healed tonight.
I want to let you know this. We love you, and God loves you. And as we're covering these scriptures, what we did tonight was build our faith tonight to receive what we need to receive. You may say, Pastor, I'm not sick, but this is what God is saying. I want you to be a healer.
Yes.
I want you to be in a position, because there's so many people that are hurting and broken out there, and they need emotional healing. They need physical healing.
Yes.
They need healing. And we serve a healer. He's in us. And all we're doing is waking up the gifts that God has given us.
Yes.
The inheritance that God has given us. Or you might be saying, Pastor, I am sick. And this message has built my faith because I wasn't sure it was God's will for me to be healed. Or you're saying, you know, I've been accepting or receiving the sickness instead of resisting it.
Yes.
Okay. And if you're sick, it's not anything bad you did. That's not what it is. We're in warfare.
That's right.
And the enemy will do everything that he can to stop you and I from being effective, from being whole, to complete the assignment. We're in a battle.
Yes, we are.
And every one of us have gotten sick one time or another. We're just right now realizing a major truth. Sickness doesn't come from God. It's God's will that I be healed.
Yes,
it's God's
God.
Will that I be saved. Do you know God doesn't want you miserable? God doesn't want you living a life with no hope. God doesn't want you separated from him. The price has been paid so you can have peace in your heart, peace in your life. Be whole, be complete.
Yes.
This is your day. Let's resist the enemy and receive everything that God has for us. And maybe it's time to claim what's yours.
Yes, God.
If right now you had a rich uncle that passed away and he left you an inheritance, put your name on it, all you'd have to do is just claim it. And Jesus already paid the price for your forgiveness, for your healing, for your total restoration of your life. And you know what you and I do? We come with our sickness.
We
come with our leprosy. We come with our condition that we've had for years of saying, wow, I didn't realize that I actually can overcome this. I just found that out today. Today, your life can change.
Yes,
and you're a prayer away. Prayer is one of the ways we receive.
Yes,
you can't receive anything from God without some faith and a prayer.
Yes, God.
And right now, what we're going to do is pray. If you need healing, we're going to pray for healing. And number two, most important, if you need salvation, and this is a question. If today were your last day on earth, you know where you spend eternity, think about that. There's going to be a day that you're going to breathe your last breath and you're going to stand before God. And what are you going to say if he asks you, why should I let you in my heaven? What are you going to say? You're going to say, I'm a pretty good person. Nowhere in the Bible does it say that good people get into heaven.
Mm-hmm.
Or you say, but I know, you know, I was a member of a church. Nowhere in the Bible does it say if you're a member of a church, you go to heaven.
That's right.
This is how we receive eternal life.
Yes.
For God so loved the world, he loves you, that he gave his only son, that whosoever, and that's me and you, that believes in him will not perish but have everlasting life. God wants to give you a gift of eternal life. And all you need to do is just believe, man, I've messed up, I've sinned, and I need some help. I need some physical healing maybe. But I need some more than that. I need some spiritual healing. I need a brand new start. Today could be your brand new day.
Yes.
Receive Jesus as your Savior. You're saying, that's me. I want a brand new day. I want to be healed in every single way.
Yes,
let's pray together. Bow your head and close your eyes right there where you're at, in your car, in your living room, in your break room, wherever you're at. This is your time. This prayer, this was going to happen, just like the guy for 38 years in a condition. this prayer changed. He now started walking. He's had a new life after one encounter with Jesus. You could have a brand new life. Live a whole new walk, a whole new way of living by a prayer. Bow your heads, close your eyes, repeat after me. Say, Jesus.
Jesus.
I receive you.
I receive you.
As my Lord.
As my Lord.
My Savior.
My Savior.
And my healer.
My healer.
Set me free.
Set me free.
From addiction.
From addiction.
Bad habits.
Bad habits.
And forgive me.
And forgive me.
I thank you, Jesus.
I thank you, Jesus.
For paying the price.
For paying the price.
For all my sins.
For all my sins.
And my completeness.
And my completeness.
Today.
Today.
I open my heart.
I open my heart.
And I accept you.
I accept you.
I receive you.
I receive you.
And every gift.
And every gift.
That you have for me.
You have for me.
I receive your peace.
I receive your peace.
I receive your freedom.
I receive your freedom.
And I receive your healing.
I receive your healing.
I am now.
I am now.
Saved.
Saved.
Born again.
Born again.
And I claim.
And I claim.
My healing right now.
My healing right
in
now.
In Jesus' name.
In Jesus' name.
I pray.
I pray.
Amen. We love you.
Amen.
If you said that prayer and you meant it, this is what we want you to do. Go online in our app and put it under praise reports. Just let us know. I just gave my life to Jesus. And we want to make sure that, and I want you to, actually it's next step.
Yeah,
you actually go to next step. It says, go on the app, it says next step, and we'll help you on your growth journey. And we're going to make sure we get you all the material that you need for you to grow. God bless you. We love you so much.
We love you guys. At this moment, we're going to go into our watch, our after party, and start sending your prayer requests. Me and Pastor Mark are going to go onto the stage right now, and we're going to start praying. We love you guys. Join us right now for the after party. We're going to start
praying. Sunday, too.
And Sunday's going to be an awesome word by Pastor Marco. And next week, Pastor Nassar Iqbal, he'll be with us right here. It's going to be a phenomenal service. We love you guys. And healing and salvation.
Be healed in Jesus' name. Love you guys.
Hey, Way fam, thanks for tuning in. I pray that you receive the blessing from this message. And if you would like to support this ministry, click the link below. And until then, see you next time.